The challenge for journalists here in North Carolina is how to chronicle a Democratic convention that will never match the excitement of the one 4 years ago, when Barack Obama was a brand new cultural phenomenon. The challenge in Tampa was very different. Scrutinizing and analyzing a nominee the country doesn't know all that well, when other storylines kept overshadowing Mitt Romney's moment. When Romney finally gave his big address, he had the unenviable task of trying to match the sky-high expectations set by the pundits.
You know there's something wrong with the kind of job he's done as president when the best feeling you had was the day you voted for him.
This was not a speech that was designed to move an audience, although Romney himself at times was moved. This was a solid speech. This was a good speech. This was not a great speech.
But there was stuff at the end that began to be very dark, very jingoistic, very anti-scientific, and really know-nothing.
Romney delivered competently delivered a well-written speech that was utterly predictable.
But with Tropical Storm Isaac finally over, Romney faced competition from what I thought was a man-made disaster, the strange spectacle of Clint Eastwood.
What? What do you want me to tell Romney? I can't tell him to do that. That can't do that to himself.
You're crazy.
You're absolutely crazy.
That was the weirdest thing I've ever seen at a political convention in my entire life.
I thought that Clint Eastwood was bizarre, and I thought it was demeaning to the presidency.
He was confusing, he was rambling, it was just a big mistake.
I did think it was a little bit weird, but after dwelling on it and watching the replays a little bit more, I thought, this ended up being an unintendedly fantastic performance.
Joining us now here in Charlotte to talk about all this, David Drucker, reporter for Roll Call, Christina Bellantoni, political editor for the PBS NewsHour, and Lauren Ashburn, editor-in-chief of Daily Download, website where I am also a contributor. Lauren, you were in Tampa. Was Clint Eastwood's performance so, shall we say, unusual that it warranted this tidal wave of media chatter and analysis?
Right? I immediately tweeted out, watching this crazy performance, this, as someone said, bizarro performance, that the RNC is going to regret it. And they're going to regret it because all of the hot air is going to be spent on Clint Eastwood, as it was. It took away from the Romney message. I remember sitting there in the hall thinking, what? What's going on? Like, what? Like a chair? You know, and I mean, it was
incoherent.
It was incoherent. He was mumbling. I couldn't hear him in the hall.
Okay, we talked about the media coverage yesterday, so it's the day after the final day of the convention. Washington Post, front page story, Clint Eastwood. Not Mitt Romney's speech. Okay, Politico, I'm not making this up. I counted 17 headlines on Politico's homepage about Clint Eastwood. A bit much?
Yes and no. An
Take
example,
a stand.
At the NewsHour, we have a YouTube feed where we put up all of the videos from the speeches. And the Clint Eastwood speech, I think the last time I checked, it had more than 300,000 views. And the Romney speech was less than 10,000. So this is something that people are interested in reading about or watching. They are Googling it. They are trying to sort of get a sense of what happened. But, of course, the media builds that up. That makes people want to go see what everybody's talking about. But what's interesting about this is whether or not it was a mistake for the RNC isn't really for me to determine. But I will say that even if he had given a really effective speech, there are a lot of people in the younger generation that just don't know who Clint Eastwood is. There were several members of our staff who were trying to, what's that movie again? They didn't know the Dirty Harry line. And so for a party that's trying to connect with a younger audience, as the Democrats obviously tend to be a little bit more successful at usually, that may not have been the right messenger.
At the end, I loved when he said, all right, everybody, fill it in. Make my day. And they all did that.
Clint Eastwood made the media's day. And I did talk to Romney advisors, David Drucker, who said they didn't know exactly what Clint Eastwood was going to do. Stuart Stevens, top strategist, told me he thought it played well in the hall. And there were a lot of people laughing at the mockery of Obama. He thought it played well in America's living rooms. We don't really know. And he doesn't care how it played in the green room, meaning the fact that most people in the press panned it.
Right. Well, let's face it. Who cares what we think? Because we're not the majority of voters. What I found interesting is of course, as journalists covering these conventions, what do we always complain about? These things are so scripted, everything's so predictable.
The minute something
happens that's not scripted and not predictable, oh my God, how could they allow this to happen? How could they do something so unscripted and not control the message? Here's what I found interesting is that while I think they could have done without this, what I think is important is how did it play at home? And for the 50-plus voter out in the heartland, out all over the country, I was checking with my family, checking Twitter, They loved it. And how are Republicans? That's so true. Republicans want to keep the younger vote down, but how are they really going to win this with the 50-plus voter who's concerned about Medicare, who's concerned about the economy? And so maybe this was a mistake, but maybe it wasn't.
After the tweet that I sent out, I got a tweet back from somebody who said, "You are so wrong. This played so well in the flyover states." That's exactly the term he used.
Well, maybe the media elite were out of touch, but I will say this. What you want if you're the nominee of the party is everybody talking about your speech the next day. And to the extent that it was Clint, make my day, I think it sucked up a lot of the media oxygen. Let me turn to the candidate's wife, Ann Romney, who probably got almost as much attention as Clint Eastwood, much anticipated speech by her on the first night of the convention. Let's play a little bit of how the reaction was, and we'll talk about it on the other side.
I thought she was very winning, obviously very attractive. Yeah. I mean, she obviously loves her husband. I mean, it's pretty manifest.
Ann Romney, on the other hand, looked to me like a corporate wife. And, you know, the story she told about struggles, it's hard for me to believe. I mean, she's a very rich woman, and I know that in America.
Wow, okay.
Ann Romney was electric, strong, and stunning.
As we see Carol Costello there, what struck me in talking to journalists was that I found a real gender split between the way male journalists reacted to this and the way women did.
Carol Costello nailed it. I mean, for women, I think, not even, you know, just journalists, but everybody, my mother, for example, were saying, wow, I've never heard her speak. Fabulous, genuine. Remember when she got up there and she went, yay. You know, she was just so real and really stuck by her husband. He said he will not fail. And I think that the media concurred.
But, well, I thought it was a very effective speech, and her job was to humanize her husband and all of that. When she said, I love you women, and she went on and on about the problems of working women trying to pay the grocery bills, which is obviously not a problem that she had, it struck me as a little bit over-the-top pandering. Let me get a male voice in here who might agree with me.
Yeah. I disagree with you, because the job of a politician is to communicate to and for the voter. No president, no first lady shares every single experience with the voter. Barack Obama, the president of the United States, is a millionaire, as he likes to remind us, but yet he still speaks to and for people that are hurting. So to the extent that Ann Romney was successful in talking to women about how they feel, which I thought she did well in doing, I think the coverage that she got from us was well-deserved.
And you have to keep in mind, this is somebody that the majority of the American people aren't necessarily tuned into this election yet. Certainly many of them aren't paying attention to the candidate's wife. And they're up against the most popular first lady in a very long time.
But circle back to my point. Did you, as a woman, and did other women you talked to, whether they like the Romney ticket or not, feel a certain resonance with Ann's message?
The best line she gave was, you know, it's not a storybook marriage. What I have is a real marriage. And I think that, you know, that certainly connected with me as a woman. And she talked about some of the fights that they had. But what was also effective was that biographical video that they played Thursday night before Clint Eastwood came out. It was either before or after.
No, it was right before.
It showed you're in their kitchen, and it shows the kids. And that's exactly what Mitt Romney's team said that they wanted to do last week. And they really did it. They showed every facet of his life. They showed a little bit behind the curtain of him. And that's what they're trying to do for the American people, to give them a sense of what he's about.
Well, where were they? You know, where were they for the last 5 months? I mean, we've been begging the Romney campaign to do something like that.
Where were they for the last 5 years?
Right. Trying to make his image that of a caring
father. And the
stories
about, you know, what he does through church and what he, you know, all of those human stories about what he did as governor. Those are the sorts of things you're probably going to be seeing in ads from here on out.
Journalists
didn't do them before.
In the last week, 2 weeks, I think there was a front page New York Times story that talked about how he... when he was in France and he was pronounced dead, he was in a car accident. I didn't know this story.
But journalists have had to go dig this out instead of the Romney campaign.
Pushing it out.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. One more thing I want to get to, and that is the way in which Tropical Storm Isaac really overshadowed, some would say rained out, this convention. Obviously the first night was canceled, but even by midweek, even by Thursday, it was still the lead story on many morning shows. Take a look at the split screen coverage.
Good evening. As we come on the air, the Republican National Convention is finally underway. You can see it right there behind me, but it is still storm watch.
I'm Anderson Cooper live in New Orleans, where all eyes are on the sky, waiting for the full force of Hurricane Isaac to hit.
And I'm Wolf Blitzer here in Tampa.
Christina Bellantoni, big storm deserves important coverage. This wasn't even a hurricane, and had it happened the week before, it wouldn't have gotten as much attention because it was intertwined with the storyline of the Republican convention.
Sure, and everybody, of course, joked, why would you ever hold a convention in Florida during hurricane season? And then it
But even when the storm moved on to Louisiana, it was still overshadowing in television terms because television loves extreme weather.
That's exactly it. It's a television story, and we'll remember 4 years ago when the Republicans are in St. Paul. You know, in both cases, this actually benefited them from a convention perspective. In 2008, you ended up canceling George W. Bush's night to speak. He delivered a speech via video instead because of that storm that was headed toward the Gulf then. And then this time, they were able to truncate things into 3 days. That allowed them to trim up some of the speakers, make sure that they got Ann Romney on Tuesday night instead of Monday night, which the network said they weren't going to cover. So in a way, it benefited them.
Can't we just shrink it to maybe 2 days total?
Well, I mean, I think Mother Nature is telling us that 3 days is plenty.
It's too much.
Let's move on to Romney's speech, because he was the guy who came after Clint Eastwood, you may recall. Because I think the media consensus was good speech, solid speech, well delivered. But there had been so much chatter about how he had to connect with voters and talk about himself more personally and grapple with and reveal more of himself. He didn't really try to do that, and I think that influenced the way the pundits graded the speech, David.
Well, I think that the problem the Romney campaign had was that there was only one campaign telling the Romney story. That was the president's campaign. And that's why I think it was so important.
You're leaving out the Fourth Estate, which keeps describing Romney as awkward, stiff, not a natural politician,
right, because,
robotic.
Right, because the Romney campaign was not telling us all of these things that they finally told us during their convention. And I think that's going to change the coverage of Romney going forward. It gives another narrative that's going to go up against the president's narrative. It changes our stock description of who Romney is.
But did this, let me go to Lauren, did this speech change our description of who Romney is? Because again, he got a B-plus from most of the media, but wasn't seen as hitting it out of the park because he didn't really talk. There were no Oprah-esque moments.
Right. There were. In looking at the media coverage, the word I kept seeing was workmanlike. You know, it was solid. He did what he had to do. He looked presidential.
Yeah. Was that a fair assessment? Did we set the bar too high? He had to somehow break through the screen. Well, most politicians can't do that.
The press to describe, you know, what this guy has to do, really, right? He's got to give a message.
Do you know how much airtime has been devoted?
Sure.
In the column, you're saying we shouldn't do that.
It's not our role. And the man was able to portray over the course of the week being very humble, mm-hmm. not liking to talk about his charitable giving, you know, being cheap. None of those things are accents, and they're little bits of pieces that he let other people tell his story.
And I think what's important is for us to stop describing or reporting on a speech in terms of what we think, but try to interpret what the voters in the states are going to feel about it. And in that regard, that's why I thought he did well.
Good advice. Lots of luck with it being filed. I got to get a break. When we come back, the political press was accused of swooning over Barack Obama in 2008. Will the tone of the convention change as this Democratic convention gets underway, the tone of the coverage in Charlotte?